Joseph and the Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat is a dazzling production of the musical by Andrew Lloyd Webber and Tim Rice. Donny Osmond stars in this new North American production. The show is a cheeky rock and roll musical based on the biblical story of Joseph and his 11 brothers at the time of the Pharaohs. During the next half hour, we'll meet Donny. We'll look behind the scenes, and we'll visit with some of the hundreds of talented people who have come together to create this spectacular musical production. So welcome to the Joseph Dreamcoat Special. Joseph and the Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat opened in London's West End in 1991, and this new North American production starring Donny Osmond premiered at the Elgin Theatre in Toronto in June 1992. For all those involved, it was a night to celebrate.
To do the music of Andrew Lloyd Webber and to sing it every night is a joy, you know? And to get the reaction from the audience that we're getting is phenomenal.
In 1968, when teenagers Andrew Lloyd Webber and Tim Rice gave birth to the idea for a musical piece about Joseph, it was a far cry from the spectacular show it has become. It was a short cantata for a school choir running about 20 minutes long.
We started something that we didn't even know would go into the theater. It was never written for the theater. It was really only written for this end-of-term concert.
The first time I met him, going to his flat, and he sat down and said, I've written 8 musicals in my school days. And he played me extracts from various scores, and I remember thinking, this guy's going to make it. This is a red-hot certainty.
Since that time, Joseph has been performed by hundreds of amateur and professional companies around the world. Andrew has become a major theater composer of shows including Jesus Christ Superstar, Evita, Starlight Express, Cats, and the ever-popular Phantom of the Opera. His contributions have been recognized with a knighthood. For Donny Osmond, the dramatic starring role as Joseph is a high point in an already illustrious career as a musician and singer.
To see for certain.
You know, this isn't just a good experience for me, but it's great for my wife and my kids because of the opportunity of traveling around, seeing different places. It's exciting because we can associate in different cultures, meet different people. Once we get open and we're not doing as many rehearsals.
We'll do that with lighting and balance and sound, the focus. There's the focus. Don't you feel ever that you've got a cut, but basically here we are on stage, right?
Could it be that I was born for higher things than you, or is it, could it be that I was born for higher things than you?
It's not worried, it's bright.
Not worried at all.
Hey, do you think that means I'm going to be king?
When I was 5 years old, I saw my brothers performing on television, and I said, I want to do that someday.
And let's get on with the show.
I don't care how hard it is. It was really hard work, but I had a dream in mind. I had a hope, and I had an aspiration of being on stage.
Donny first caught the public ear at the age of 6 when he joined the Osmonds. The superstar group scored a steady string of top 40 hits around the world. By the time he was 13, Donny was a solo phenomenon, creating hit after pop hit. During a 9-year period, he earned 23 gold records. 8 went gold in 1 year alone. For a young Donny Osmond who grew up in a family of 9 children and lived in the hills of Utah, the world of show business must have been full of contrasts.
And the winner is...
for the best vocal team of the year!
Donny later made television history at the age of 17 when he and his sister Marie became the youngest hosts of a weekly one-hour television variety program, The Donny and Marie Show.
There were only two things, Michael Jackson and Donny Osmond.
The moment Donny came into the room, we were seeing and meeting lots of different people. He just seemed to have the mixture of innocence and experience, which is ideal, because the actor playing Joseph must go, in age terms, from 17 to about 40, and in psychological terms, from being a young, naive, insensitive, callow youth to a man who can save the whole of the Middle East from famine and be big enough to forgive his brothers. That's quite a tall order.
And then I come over here and you let go, thank you.
What I have to do as Joseph is I really have to believe this, man. I really have to believe that what I am envisioning and dreaming is really gonna happen. When I started working with the children, it brought back a lot of memories of what I've been through. Not that I think they should all be in show business, because it's not for everyone. But if it does anything, it snaps something in them about dreaming, about wishing and wanting and hoping, because without that inside, you're nothing.
Voices for the children's choir in Joseph are selected through a choral challenge between school choirs in the local area.
Hang on a dance if you make it someday. Wearing my shades, I'm walking down the street.
50 voices are an integral part of each performance of Joseph, and that requires 2 alternating choirs, 100 children in all.
The show was written for children originally by Andrew, and it's very important to him that it's enjoyed by children. And they're on stage the whole way through the show, not only singing, but part of it.
There have been 2 or 3 exceptional choirs, and really beautiful sound and precision. And there are a few kind of like what I could call like rascal type rogue choirs, you know, who they can sing, but they also have a lot of kids who you know are going to get up to mischief. As soon as you get running down the corridors, they're going to be one who's going to be screaming and shouting and fighting, but you need that.
Shaping the voices of the choir takes many weeks of vocal and staging rehearsals, long hours of dedication before these lucky children gain the rewards of performing in front of a live audience.
Joseph is a real character at the beginning. He is a somewhat of a cocky know-it-all, and that's why his brothers hate him so much. He comes up with all these dreams, and he has the audacity to tell his brothers, including his father, that they are going to bow down to him someday. I'd be upset too.
Joseph was hated by his older brothers because he was his father's favorite son. And when the father gave Joseph a beautiful coat of many colors, the brothers were so angry they sold Joseph as a slave. He was hauled off across the desert into the land of ancient Egypt. In Egypt, the youthful Joseph serves a rich and powerful man called Potiphar. In this scene, a seductive Mrs. Potiphar takes a fancy to Joseph, which leads to even more troubles for the innocent youth.
Joseph is a loving man. Everybody can love him. He can make people happy. He can empathize. He can be something to everybody. You know, because he goes through so much, everybody that watches him can relate to what he's going through.
If my life were important, I would ask, will I live or die? But I know the answers lie far from this
Dreamcoat Special. We'll be right back.
Well, I was wandering along the banks of the river when seven fat cows came out of the Nile.
After some years, the Pharaoh hears of Joseph's extraordinary ability to interpret dreams. The Pharaoh releases Joseph from jail and orders him to interpret his rock and roll dreams.
I've been a musician and singer, actor all my life, and this is a dream come true for me. And pursuing such a career as an actor is, they tend to call you the dreamer. I did a show on Broadway called Elvis, an American Musical, which was a history of Elvis Presley's life, where I played Elvis from 21 to 37. I had 26 costume changes. I grew up in a pretty musical, crazy little family. I was one who was inspired to sing and show off. I was the youngest brother, wanted to outdo my older brothers, as you do when you're growing up. I've been able to take something that I believe comes kind of naturally to me to kind of do Elvis, and now to be able to recreate the Pharaoh through this rock and roll character, an Elvis type character.
But let me show you how we really rock and roll here in Egypt, baby. Maestro, hit it, baby. Come on. All right.
When Joseph was written in the late 1960s, it was a time of psychedelic fashions, anti-war protests, and flower power. The show integrates influences from that time into the ancient world of the pharaohs. Joseph is a form of theater called pastiche, which combines a variety of musical styles into one piece.
What we tried to do was, however kind of broad the pastiche was, we were always telling the story so that, for example, Pharaoh the King becomes the King of Rock, becomes Elvis. But we didn't want to sell the story down the line for the sake of a theatrical effect.
Once we go into Egypt, we wanted to set up a big visual, pa-pa, you know, at the top of the second half, so it would feel very different.
The rich costumes are inspired by traditional period dress from the lands of ancient Canaan and Egypt. But in keeping with the spirit of fun, there's usually a twist. In the palace of a rock and roll pharaoh, even Egyptian princesses wear white bobby socks and blue suede shoes. The show has levels of wit and humor designed to appeal to audiences of all ages.
We see the whole show through the eyes of the children. It begins with the narrator, like a Sunday school teacher, or talking to the children, and then she magically transforms her classroom world into this extraordinary journey.
He was a powerful man, the ancient world in the palm of his hand, to all intents and purposes was Egypt with a capital E.
Andrew Lloyd Webber's music is probably some of the most difficult stuff to sing. It is thrilling and exciting to sing because he matches the highest notes with the most exciting and climactic moments of every song and every scene.
I think almost you want to smile on that.
At the beginning?
Yeah. I think a little softer.
I can't remember what you told me. Do I have enough freedom on this to do back phrase?
Well, it's not back phrasing so much.
It's very rewarding, especially to be singing the music of a man who has had an enormous amount of hits and is very well known. There are a lot of moments within the show that are very rewarding.
Take my music with me.
And then, of course, there are the big, you know, belty numbers, you know, where I sort of get to sing out with a big chorus and orchestra behind me. There's nothing like it. It doesn't get any better than that.
There's a lot of trust that goes out on stage. I look at somebody and I give an emotion, I get it right back. That's how professional these people are. And that's the joy of working with this company.
Benjamin is straighter than the big bamboo. No ifs,
no ifs,
no buts,
no buts.
honest as coconuts.
The Joseph Company of musicians, singers, dancers, and actors were chosen specifically for their ability to handle the extraordinary musical and physical demands of the production.
We are the criminal and guilty ones. Oh no,
oh no.
I got all the motivation I need when I think about the fact that I'm going to be out there in a loincloth.
Lift. I want two more. Ready? Up. And up. Two. Four.
Oh, baby!
Beautiful.
I've never been in a production where I've had to wear the kind of attire that I have to wear on stage, but... as a singer, you know, you work on your vocal cords, and it's about the only muscle you're really concerned about. But what do you think? What do you think? At least I'm taller.
The wonderful thing about theatre, obviously, is such a mishmash. It's a chemistry. And hopefully, like a good chemical equation, everybody comes out maybe a bit changed.
I dreamed that in the fields one day the corn gave me a sign. Your 11 sheaves of corn...
Part of the appeal of an Andrew Lloyd Webber show is the enduring quality of its music. Joseph is rich in both melody and the range of musical styles. A pastiche from Western country to calypso, rock and roll to dramatic pop. A French cabaret style number called Those Canaan Days is a good example of Andrew's ability to generate dramatic mood.
There's kind of sad chords, a sad tune, and it's a perfect pastiche, again, to use that word, a perfect song to use at a time when it's meant to portray these brothers who have been starving since Joseph has left, and it's wonderful how the music works and tells that story in this sad, doleful way. People can identify with a style. If I go, you know it's rock and roll. If I do that, you know it's gonna be a country style.
When I think of his last great battle, and it all comes to my throat, it takes a man who knows how to fight to rise with the old.
Soft to far and very few cast, he was one of Egypt's
have all those things. At the end of the day, there's a show there, which is very special, and people can identify. And I guess that's what we've tried to achieve all the way through, that we, whatever we add to it, it never loses its simplicity.
Meant that I could really live in
the piece is about a man who dreams, a dreamer, who sees the cruelties and the harshnesses of life, faces them head on. He doesn't pretend that the world is a great, great place always. It isn't. And works through that, makes a success of his life. But what he does say to us all is that we have to go on dreaming. We must dream. That's all we can do to counterbalance all the famine and starvation and difficult things that we'll come across in our own personal lives.
After that, the future doesn't look so bright. Egypt's luck will change completely overnight. In famine's hand, we'll start the land with food at all time low. Noble king, there is
at the end of the show, it's wonderful when Joseph meets his father, and then Joseph sings, Any Dream Will Do. So it's a wonderful dramatic tie-up. It's very complete.
I wore my coat with golden lining, bright color shining, wonderful and blue. And in the east, the dawn was breaking, and the world was waking.
crash of drums,
a flash of light.
My golden coat flew out of sight. The colors faded into darkness. I was left alone. May I return
about Joseph is that it is a very serious, interesting, exciting story, and it's told very honestly by Tim Rice and Andrew Lloyd Webber. You could tell Joseph as a tragedy, or as a light comedy, or as a thriller. What you need to know is the way you're telling it, and the way we're telling Joseph is through the forms of musical comedy, through pastiche, through fun, through dancing, through colourful scenery. But what's important is to hold on to the story of Joseph and the truth of that story.